Hi, welcome to our session. Maybe first we introduce ourselves. We are Wolfgang. Hi. Wolfgang is a core developer and the maintainer of the rules module. My name is Christian, and together we are running a Drupal company in Vienna, Austria, called Tronomics. What can you expect during this session? Yeah, you know, maybe you know the title of the session. It's all about social media, the rules module, APIs, and automation stuff.
Yeah, so I hope some of you already know the rules module. So who doesn't know the rules module here? Okay, so maybe for those of you, a short explanation. The rules module is one of the popular Drupal 7 modules, I would say, and it allows you to react on various events that happen on your website using conditions and actions. So for example, when a user does something on your website, it triggers events like a content node is being viewed, or when a user registers, or when a user logs in. And those are events that you can react on then with rules. And then the modules provide all different kinds of conditions and action you can make use of to react on those events. For example, a common use case would be just when a user logs in and you check the condition. If he doesn't has filled out his user profile, you redirect him to the page where he actually should fill it out and send him a message or something like that. So the rules module is quite powerful and useful, I would say, when it comes to Drupal, as a lot of modules integrate with it. But I think it would be also very cool if you could use it to react up external events, like let's say a tweet happens to tweet about a topic that you're interested in and you want to react up on that. Or a Facebook message is posted to your status, to your Facebook page or something like that. Or I think it would be also really cool if it could do it the other way around. So if something happens on your Drupal site, post something to Facebook, to Twitter, or to any other service.
Yes, now you can. And even Ethan seems to like it.
My laptop doesn't like it. Nach unten drückt. Nee, nach rechts muss drücken. Okay.
Okay, maybe some examples. A typical example would be when you have a tweet on Twitter and you want to post this tweet automatically on Facebook. So you save some time, would be a typical use case. Another use case would be saving Facebook posts as Drupal entities. So you can have the Facebook postings in your Drupal system as entities available, listed with views, and make it searchable, for example. Would be another example. And a use case using files would be having your Flickr pictures automatically saved in your Dropbox, maybe for backup reasons. But yeah, maybe you are asking now, why the hell do I need this? There's a tool like If This Then That that is doing exactly the same thing as a software as a service. Yeah, we have some points here. When using Drupal and rules, you have far more flexibility, especially when you want to connect and integrate with your local Drupal system. And there are hundreds of events, conditions, and actions available already in your Drupal system, because nearly every Drupal module has rules integration. And you can't use it when you use an external system like if this and that. When you use a system like if this and that, probably you have an RSS feed you can use, but that's mostly all of it. And of course, there's also a seamless integration to the Drupal's entity API. So you can just create any entity you like and populate it with stuff from the various APIs. So, maybe you know Drupal is open source. I don't have to tell you the advantages of using open source software. But a very important point here is that you are able to integrate your own tools, services. For example, if you have your own project management tool and you want to integrate it with the system, you can do it. It's all about data. This is another very important part. A lot of companies, especially in Europe, don't want to host their system in US, for example, per reason. For them, it's a very big deal to have a self-hosted system, so they can decide where they want to host this. The Drupal. And you don't need to authenticate third-party applications. When they use a service like if this and that, normally you have to give away permissions to an application that is owned by somebody else. And for example, a Facebook application, you give away the permission that the Facebook application can access your profile data, or you can post in your name. When you use Drupal, maybe you have to add and set up your own application. It would be a little bit more work to set up, but you can go sure that nobody is misusing your permissions.
Yeah, and also what I think is really makes me even more important in that case, at least for me, is that when you automate that stuff and you like automate Twitter and Facebook and Dropbox and everything to play together, then you have all that authentication permissions at one single central place. Like if you automate it like with if.com, they have access to all your online services at once. So to me, that has been really the point where I say, okay, I don't want to give them the keys to all of my stuff.
Okay, and maybe the most important point, a lot of content is usually outside of your CMS nowadays. And think about comments or tweets. And also, most of the interaction is happening outside of your CMS. So when people want to automate stuff, they usually want also to be able to react on these events. And also, there are a lot of nice and cool APIs and tools available out there. And they can be used to bring some intelligence into your Drupal system. Example would be some analytics APIs like CUMods or CloudScore. If these APIs would have rules integration, you can just query CloudScore for a Drupal user, which CloudScore the Drupal user has, and react on this event or have it as condition. So this would be very powerful, and there are a lot of APIs out there that you can use.
Yeah, so maybe let's have a close look at how this all works now. So during the last months, we worked on a project which we called Fluxcraft, and it's essentially exactly that. The Fluxcraft project just combines rules with external services, and then it takes that all and packages together in a more easy to use install distribution. But it's not only a distribution, it's also a module suite. So it follows the approach, as you might know it, from, let's say, Drupal Commerce. So it's a module suite that implements all the functionality. You can install it on your own Drupal site and run it, and it works just perfectly fine. But there's a distribution which just has everything you need in a place, and you can install it without having to take care of about all installing module use dependencies and all that stuff. So it's easier to use. So the Flux module suite is what essentially powers that all. It's, as said, just the rules integration for all the external services so that you can make use of them from your Drupal side. And really the heart of that, the central module, is the Flux service integration module, which kind of provides the lower level central place for all the integration module. And the special integration module starter services, like the connection to Twitter, Facebook, Flickr, or whatever, then builds up in that framework. So you install the Flux services integration module, all of its dependencies and everything, and then you just need to add in the connection module to whatever service you want to use, like Flickr, Twitter. Yeah, so there are separate modules for the connections to the other services as well, like there is a Flux Flickr module, for example. Yeah, and when you have installed that, you end up with a UI that looks like that. So some of you probably know it. It's just the regular rules overview screen. You can just configure rules as usual, and you have new actions, conditions, and events in there, which allow you to interact with the newly added service. And as you might see from in the menu, there are also some new menu points from the Flux Services Integration module, which allow you to manage service accounts and service endpoints. But we'll have a closer look at that later on. And when you install the FluxGraph distribution, for that you just need to download the prepackaged distribution terminal and install it as any regular Drupal installation. So you can get the terminal from FluxGraph.com or from the Drupal.org project page. You just download and install it, and you're ready to go. And it looks like that then. So it comes with its own theme. And it also provides a little bit nicer overview to the FluxGraph specific rules in the distribution. So we decided to go with some icons here as well, and we render what's in your rules, so you can have a very quick view of actually what are your rules doing and with which services are you interacting. Yeah.
Yeah, and just a quick side note for developers. Attention, FluxGraph uses object-oriented programming. So maybe some of you say, what?
I don't care.
Isn't this a Drupal 8 thing? Why the hell is this now also in Drupal 7? So this is by reason, because we can use libraries like the Gussel library that is some sort of HTTP web service client. And yeah, the port to Drupal 8 is very easy, so more or less.
Yeah, so the port is very easy because it's not a lot to do. We really followed already Drupal 8 development principles in Drupal 7, have a different, a similar class structure and everything. So the port of the software will be very simple.
Yeah, maybe this way some external developers come into the project because they know the Gussel module, but you know, don't know Drupal, so less Drupalism maybe is a good way.
Yeah, so let's have a short look at the basic concept of the Flux Services Integration module. So first off, as you already shortly mentioned at the menu points, that's the concept of service endpoint. And service endpoints are just used to hold your the information that's needed to talk to a specific service. Like when you talk to the Twitter API, as to most of the other services, you just need to provide some API credentials so that Twitter knows who is talking with its API. And the service endpoint user interface allows you to manage that settings. And yeah, the module also provides it as a framework for developers to store that settings, so you don't have to take care of that yourself. And it's working very similar for the service accounts, which are then the accounts under which the actual actions are performed. Like when we take Facebook, for example, if you want to post something on your Facebook page, you always need to provide the Facebook account under which the action will have to be performed. And the Flux Service Integration module comes with a central place to manage the accounts for talking to the different social media services or services in general. So it allows you to create multiple service user accounts, like when you have Twitter, you cannot only use one Twitter account, you can connect multiple Twitter accounts with it. So that's for the overall Drupal site, you can do that. But in addition to that, there's an extension module, which you can enable, which then will allow you to have PR user service accounts also. So you can allow the users of your Drupal site to add and manage their own connection accounts to service accounts to Twitter, Facebook, and so on. Yeah, so I think that's also UI-wise very nice feature, because you really don't want to have a separate screen for each of the social services you interact with for your users. So it's very nice to have that all combined on one screen. Yeah, and then another concept that the Flux Service integration makes use of is remote entities. So who of you doesn't know what a Drupal entity is? No one? Perfect. So maybe a remote entity is not that well known, so I explain that shortly. A remote entity works with the same API, the entity API, but it does implement the API in that way, in that it doesn't talk to your local database at all, so it directly talks to the web service. So it's like when you're working with Twitter, there is a remote entity for a Twitter message, and when you load it, it just directly talks to the Twitter web service, and it doesn't hit your database at all, and it also doesn't mean that your tweets are stored in your database. But what's very nice about having the remote entities is that it's very well integrated with Drupal and also with rules that way, because lots of modules just build up in the concept of entities in Drupal, like we all have the token replacements and everything working with it. Yeah, so what kind of services do we have support already? So we have implemented integration modules for Twitter, Facebook, also for RSS and ADOM feeds, for Dropbox, Flickr, and we also have two modules which are more in development state for LinkedIn and Xing. Those two also work very well, basically, but they're not complete yet, so they only cover a very small portion of the published APIs. Yeah, so I think it's time for some action and to actually see how you can make use of that. So in the first example, I'd like to show you on how we could connect Facebook and Twitter. So in a way that when something is posted to a Facebook page of you, that it's automatically also published on your Twitter account. So for the examples, we have prepared some screencasts so we can work even if the internet connection fails. Let's hope they are working. Okay, so this is the rules overview screen, as you have seen it already on a screenshot. It's the theme of the distribution. And as usual, you have to get started first by making sure you have all your service accounts set up. So in that test set, we already have added three Twitter accounts and a Facebook account. Okay, and then you can just move on and add rules as you're used to. Let's move a bit further. So here you can see it. This is the regular screen to add a rule. You just enter the name tags as usual. And then you have to select the event. And now here the integration modules provides dedicated events to the that match to certain actions that happen on the remote, on the social services. Like on Facebook, we have events here right now for being able to react on status messages being posted on a friend's timeline, on a group's timeline, on page's timeline, events timeline, and on your own timeline. So in this example, I would like to use a page of the Facebook account. So we just select that and move on. So select it. And once you have selected it, it needs some additional settings for really to figure out which page you want to use. So once you have selected it, you see that it reloads the form, and first it asks you what's the Facebook account you're going to use, and it just displays you a drop down of all the accounts that are in the system. We have the Eine Einstein account here, and then you have to select the page you want to react up, and it also shows you just the pages you have access to. In our example, we use Einstein's fan page, use it and create the rule. You end up on the regular rules overview screen, and now we can move on adding conditions and actions. So maybe a short explanation. So that rule, So that rule will now be executed then for each of the posts. So if someone posts something on the Facebook page, it will be executed for each of this of the posts. So now we wanna have that post moved over to Twitter. So for that, we just add another action, which sends a tweet. And fortunately, that's provided by the Flux Twitter integration module. We have a send tweet action, so we just select that. And as usual for the actions, you just configure its parameters and you're done. And the send tweet message obviously needs the text you want to tweet. And in this example, we just switch to the data selector, what allows us to just select the data from the Facebook page we are reacting up. As you can see, we have here the message available. We just select the message text to tweet that. Then the Twitter send tweet action needs another parameter as well. It needs to know with which Twitter account do you actually want to send the tweet. So you can select here the Twitter accounts that are available in your system as well. And in our example, we use Future Doc Brown's Twitter account. Okay, so just move on. So we have the rule now configured. We have an event, and it will trigger the whole rule and just execute the action. So now for testing this, you have to run the cron service of your Drupal site manually, because that's the way it works is behind the scenes. When you react up an event on a service, it needs to poll the service and ask whether there's something new, and that happens during the cron runs. And usually, yeah, you configure it on your server to run the cron, let's say, every 5 minutes. So we would have to wait 5 minutes for the interaction to actually happen. But for testing stuff, it's best to just run cron manually, so you see the results. Okay, so to test it, we post a message on Einstein's fan page. We'll just post something here. So this is a Facebook post, send it, and then we run cron. Let's move on a bit. So it ran. Now we check whether the tweet is here. So this is Future Doc Brown's Twitter account, and this is a Facebook post already appeared, so it worked. And in case you want to follow Future Doc Brown to get news from the future, the account is at Future Doc Brown. Okay. Let's see what else we have.
Yeah, another way would be to have automatic retweeting. In this case, we have two Twitter accounts. The one is Future Doc Brown, the one is Doc Brown Past. And we want to retweet all tweets by Future Doc Brown by the user account Doc Brown Past. So yeah, let's start again with configuring the rule. Just name it how you like it, and the event would be in this case under the group Twitter. We have a new tweet appears on a user timeline. So the user timeline would be then the Future Doc Brown user timeline. And here is it important that we have to also edit and display an account or an account giveaway. and have an account that queries the data, and we need to specify the Twitter user we want to, which tweet we want to get into the system. So again, every time when FutureDoc Brown is tweeting something, this rule will be executed, and we can have some actions that react on this event. So in this case, we have an action available that is called retweet. We just have chosen this action, and we react on the tweet entry. And we want to send a tweet with retweet with the user Twitter account DocBrown passed. When we have done this, it's already working. It should already work. And we can again test on the live system. Here, FutureDocBrown is adding a tweet. He wants to be retweeted. And if it's working, it should be retweeted after running the cron immediately by DocBrown passed. Yeah, let's see. Here's a retweet. So the past has retweeted your future somehow.
Okay. So let's see whether we have some examples that don't involve Twitter. So I've got here an example I'm using personally also. It's sending an email when there's a new RSS item. Nothing very fancy, but still useful. I use it to just send me interesting blog posts of the Drupal Planet, so I have it with me in my mailbox. But in that example, I'll show you how to use it to just send me an email about feed entries coming of our company's blog. So let's have a check in the video. So again, we start off at the rules overview screen and just add a new rule and start over providing with it with a name that makes sense, Tronomics feed email notification, and choose the event we want to react on. So for that use case, the feeds integration module provides us with an event which is called a new feed entry appeared. So you select that, and then, of course, you have to configure which feed you want to use. So you just have to enter the feed URL, and you can also configure the polling interval so it doesn't necessarily poll every cron run. Yeah, that's it. Once you have configured it, you will have a rule that executes for each of the feed entries, and you can add an action to do something. And as all the regular rule stuff is available, of course, there's also the send email action available. So we can just combine that and use send email and configure the send email action as usual. So we just enter the email address we want to send it, enter some subject and message. Nothing very fancy here. So we move on a little bit. Maybe more interesting is that here. So for the message text, you might want to make use of some replacements of the feed entry. And the way it works with the remote entities, as we mentioned earlier, is that now we have all that stuff available that's in the feed, also as token replacement and two rules. So we can select here the feed title, link, content, language descriptions, and stuff like that. So in this example, yeah, I think we just use the title and the link and send me to that. Of course, you could add more. Yeah. So that's it. You save it, and we should be good to go. That's the rule. And again, we also test it to make sure it works. And go back here to the rules overview screen. You actually also see how the overview works. So when you hover on an icon, it displays you some additional information about the action that's configured here. So that's actually, we think, pretty handy, so you don't have to click on the rule and to go into it to see all the details. So the overview can provide you with all necessary information to know what your rules are doing. So, let's test it. Run cron. Cron ran successfully. That means we should have an email now of our last blog entry. And here it is, the new feed item. Yes. So, it works. Yes, but as always, there are some caveats and things that are not so obvious, but good to know. So we would like to tell you them now, so you don't have to run into it yourself.
Yeah, it is highly recommended that you configure the cron on your server. Don't use the built-in Drupal cron. It's not really reliable for this use case. And also check the API limits. For example, the Twitter API has some limits, and I don't know the exact numbers, but you can of course only query maybe 115 tweets per second. I don't know the numbers, but they care about this. And
During development, also it happened to us. We tested some retweeting and. We accidentally retweeted, I think, 200 tweets at once, and yeah, immediately our Twitter account was blocked.
Yeah, so this is the next part. Respect the API's terms of services. Most APIs have some terms of services. And for example, Twitter don't want much automating stuff happening. It's allowed in some kind. But retweeting, for example, is not allowed if you just retweet every tweet that has some mention or some hashtag included. For example, when somebody is retweeting every tweet that is mentioning DrupalCon, it's definitely spam. So makes no sense, and you will be suspended by Twitter immediately.
Yeah, okay, so let's go back to the future and see what the future is going to bring us. So our next steps really first off is to work on sharing rules on fluxcraft.com. So the idea is that on fluxcraft.com you can export the rules you locally have in Drupal and put it on the site, so for others, so that they can find useful rules easily and you can share them. So we're actually already working with that, and it will go live pretty soon. Next thing we want to improve is we want to improve scheduling. As you might know, the rules module already includes the rules scheduler module, which is very powerful, and you can already schedule basically everything with it. But it's not necessarily very simple to set up. I mean, there are some tutorials and everything, so you can figure it out. But it's not as easy as it could be, in particular for the use cases when you just want to postpone retweeting or something like that. So we want to make that easier and to set up, so you can just set the date basically, and while configuring the action, you're done. And next, we also want to work on improving logging. All the social media activity under your name and everything might be quite important for you. I think it makes sense to be able to really control and see what happened. And for that, you might want to have really good logging functionalities. Right now, you can do that already also with the built-in rules actions. You can build basically your own log and make sure it works for you. But I think we might want to do that, sort of improve it so that there's more sensible default logs that work out of the box. Yeah, and of course, we want to work on improving and providing more documentation so that there are many tutorials and everything is ready so that folks can easily dive into it. But as always, providing lots of great documentation, it's not easy, and it could use a lot of help of you guys so that we can make sure it's really great. So it's one of our goals, really, to also build an active community of happy users around the project, so this can be really successful, because I think that's the only way it really can be. It really needs contributions of a lot of people to make sure it works out of a lot of services, and it's very easy to just integrate another service because already someone wrote a module for it. And if it's not fine for you, maybe just extend it a little bit, share it with others, and the next one will be happy as well. And for that to really work out, I think what's fundamental is that that we make integrating with new APIs fun and as easy as possible. So that's really also one of our goals, and we already worked hard on it to make it as easy as possible to implement and connect with a new service. Yeah, ideas.
Yeah, we have also some ideas about use cases. So one is the Flux service module can function as a base for social media integration in general.
Yeah, as I shortly mentioned already, it's really the central place to connect all the APIs. And it's really also a nice framework for developers. So you can use it to store your API credentials, to store the service accounts, and everything that's taken care of for you. So it really makes that easier. Then, as mentioned, it all works with remote entities. It also eases implementing remote entities a lot because, just with the entity API, it's not something really simple to figure out, but the Flux service integration module provides necessary base classes and everything that basically work out of the box, and you just need to implement what's really custom per service usually. Yeah, so it really provides a nice framework for integrating with new services. Yeah, and then the last point I really want to mention here is also the user interface. I already mentioned it shortly previously. I think it's really critical to have a central place where you can configure all your service accounts of all different kind of social media services. It doesn't make a sense to have 10 different UIs for 10 different social media services. No one wants to have that. Content marketing.
Yeah. We have some ideas how you can use rules and Drupal also for content marketing. Of course, it's good to have content on the website, maybe enhanced by Flickr pictures or Instagram pictures. But you also can provide some functionality for your editors that they can schedule tweets after they created content. There's a way you can provide a user interface for this that they can easily schedule tweets promoting the content and say maybe tomorrow 12 o'clock I want to send out a tweet promoting the content I just created. So I think this could be very helpful.
Yeah, another idea that came to my mind was also easy developer automation. So for example, if you commit something to GitHub and you have a Drupal-based project management tool, it would be very easy to just have GitHub integration, make sure that all the commits appear at the task that matches the commit, and doing some stuff like that. Or personally, I also would like to look into automating some issue queue stuff. So when we work with Drupal.org projects and you're maintaining modules, it sometimes is a lot of work and you have to do a lot of repeated tasks. And I think it would be really interesting to look into automating that with the power of rules and the connection to it also. Yeah, then integration with other self-hosted tools.
Yeah, in case you don't want the NSA to have access to your data, or you want to try that the NSA don't have access to your data.
Good luck.
It makes sense you work with self-hosted systems. One example is the OnCloud system. Probably you know it. It's kind of an open alternative to Dropbox and a self-hosted system. And when you're using some of this, it makes sense that you use also a self-hosted system for the automation stuff. And you don't use if this and that, where everything is all again going over some services you don't have, you don't know and you don't trust, more or less. And finally, it would be very nice if we could connect Drupal to the Internet of Things. And I think there's a lot of possibilities out there in this direction. And there are a lot of things that you can automate. And
all the things.
For example, just an easy example, when somebody's ordering at your commerce, Drupal commerce store, some lights go on and stuff like this, or yeah, be creative.
Okay, so maybe before we go ahead with the questions, I think we have another example we could show off. Should we go with questions? Maybe let's start with the questions first, and if there's still some time left, we can show you another example. So, any questions? Thank you. So if you have any questions, please come up to the mic so everyone can hear you.
Hi, really, really great module. I wanted to ask about authentication with Facebook and Twitter. You're making a Facebook application or Twitter app and doing the authentication with those apps, or how is it working?
So the way it works that first you have to configure a Twitter app, for example, if you're using your dev account at Twitter, and then you Twitter provides you with the API credentials, and you have to provide those credentials at the service endpoint once. Mm-hmm. So those basically work for the whole of your Drupal site. And then for the individual interactions, you need the accounts in addition. So you can have multiple accounts associated with your Twitter app. So when you add an account, it just goes through the regular OAuth authenticating process. And as you know it, you grant to Twitter access to your account. And the OAuth credentials come back to the Drupal site and will be stored in the service account for you. And so the service account step just makes use of the approval process and the API credentials you have to just provide once upfront for the service endpoint. So does that answer your question?
Yes.
Yeah.
And another one. So if we want to extend those actions that you have for Facebook, this is possible? Or?
How do you mean accessing the actions?
Not accessing, but implementing other actions.
Yes, totally. You can just extend the module with other actions via patches, where you would really love to get patches on it and make sure to improve the modules and to work on that. And of course, it's Drupal, it's all modular. You can do your own module and add your own actions via another module as well. And we haven't mentioned it that much in this presentation. Also that the modules are very nice integration with all the APIs, so they don't come with any UI out of the box. So if you're just a developer who is interested in talking to Twitter, Facebook API or something, it's also very handy to just to install the module, to don't use the rules integration, but just to use the API because it's very nicely integrated and makes it very easy to use the whole framework, as it covers already the authentication stuff and everything for you. And you can just move on with a web service client. And in that case, we have used Castle and talk to the service.
Yeah, there's a buff tomorrow.
Yeah, we should mention we have a buff tomorrow. So if you're interested into developing something based upon the Flux Services integration module, or maybe integrating with new services, or have development related questions, please come to our buff. I think it's tomorrow at 1 o'clock at the lunch area, but please look it up.
Hi, I just have a quick question about the interface changes that you've done to actually make it look a bit more like Give This Then That. And my question is whether you're also considering to actually use some of those interface patterns that other services use that are so super easy also for creating rules. Because at the moment, I have the feeling that that's one of the major pains, actually, that creating a rule, just the amount of data that you can select and the stuff that you can trigger, that there's so much mm-hmm. that if you don't have a deep understanding of Drupal, there's no way that you can actually create a decent rule. So are you also considering to work on that part so that it may be much easier to create new rules, at least for a subset of kind of pre-prepared triggers, for an example?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we have really been thinking about that also for the Fluxkraft project, and we even worked out some mock-ups and everything, but it just turned out that implementing a completely new and improved rules user interface was ahead of the project. But we really have great ideas, I think, on that. And maybe we'll make, if we find the resources that are necessary to do it, we'll do that for the Drupal 8 version of Rose if it works out. For Drupal 7, probably not anymore. Yeah, but yeah, there are some great ideas which really are also going in the direction you're mentioning of reducing of what you see by default and just, but still making everything possible, but just hiding the more advanced stuff by default from the user and also hiding stuff that you don't need in a certain use case and putting the stuff in front of the user that he's more likely to use in a certain situation.
Okay, thank you. And another question related to that is that at the moment, the markups that you've shown are basically rules that you've created already that look kind of like this and that, so that you can easily activate and deactivate them.
Yeah.
So is that for all rules now, or is that just for the ones that actually use web services?
So that's working for all rules, actually, but it's right now a user interface which just comes with the Fluxkraft module. You could perfectly fine just go ahead and use it with rules which are tuple only and do not relate with any interfaces as well. It's just that other rules modules that integrate with rules don't provide any icons right now. So it has some nice fallback to generate an icon based upon the letters of the module, but of course that's not so nice as a real icon. But it is very easy to add an icon. We really thought it through, so you can just enter class names of Font Awesome, I think. Font Awesome, and it directly appears in the user interface, so it's not hard to add icons also for modules if you take care of that.
Okay, thanks.
Any further questions? Okay, so are you still interested in looking at another example? Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's do that. Do you want to do it? Okay, so the last example we have prepared is automating Twitter lists. And what's the idea behind it? Could you explain it?
Yeah, Twitter lists are very handy. You can just have a list of Twitter users, maybe all Twitter users that are posting about DrupalCon. So our goal was to prepare a Twitter list, automate a Twitter list that about all people that are talking about DrupalCon in Twitter. So
yeah.
This would be the goal, and you can just start a screencast.
Yeah, so as always, we start over with the rules overview screen. We add a new rule. Here we have the service accounts. So here it is. We add a new rule. And then we react up an event, and in this case, we use a different event as previously. The Twitter module provides an event which is called a new tweet matches a search term. So this event allows you to react up any Twitter search, basically. You just choose it, and you have to select the Twitter account under which the search will be performed, and you enter the search term. So in that example, we want to look for DrupalCon-related tweets. So we just enter the search term DrupalCon. Yeah, let's move on. Then we end up with the created rule. So the rule will be triggered for each tweet matching the search. And we add a new action to actually retweet something now. To add it to a list. We have an action for that, which is called, how is it called?
Add to a list.
Add a Twitter user to a list, I think. Yeah, add a user to a Twitter list. So you select that action, and then of course you have to tell the action which Twitter account you want to use. So this is the Twitter account who would own the Twitter list you want to use. Then you can see all the lists that the user owns. So it just directly fetches all the lists from Twitter. And we already have created the DrupalCon list here, which we select here. Then you have to tell it which users it should add to that list. That's the last parameter. So you could just enter a fixed user here, but that's boring. So we go to the data selector and we select the user who actually wrote the tweet we are acting upon. So we need the screen name here. And yeah, move on, save the rule. And that's it. So we've got a rule. And now each time Gron runs, it will perform the search query, look whether there's a new tweet it hasn't handled yet, and add the one who is tweeting to the list. And actually, we've got it running, right?
Yeah, it's a live use case.
So we can look at the results on your account. It's here at least. Let's see how many people are already in there. So we have got 481 members already. So yeah, it's working. Good.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And as always, please do not forget to fill out the session evaluation. And we also have an announcement to make, which is not related to the session, but we want to make use of the opportunity. So in November, we'll have a Drupal camp in Vienna, so it's not far off. It will be really great, so join us if you are interested.
Hi everyone. Just a quick announcement as well. The Drupal.org content working group wants to improve Drupal.org for site builders. One thing they're working on is on building landing pages where you can find relevant information around site building topics. They're working to find out what has to be done on those pages, and that's where you can help. If you have 30 minutes to talk about how you can figure things out with Drupal and on Drupal.org, please leave your name and some contact details at this form on a form. I'll give the URL in a second, or come up front and write it down. Working group members will contact you and set up a convenient time to have this chat. So the URL is bit.ly/sbinterview. But you can come up here and get it, bit.ly/sbinterview.